Welcome to Reluctantly Supernatural in an Age of Reason, the podcast where we explore the place of the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit in our lives and in the church. Our hosts, Pastors Mark Cowper-Smith and Bob Maddox, combine their years of ministry experience to address the issues of the prophetic gifts in our modern world. Join us as they interview their guests from a wide variety of spiritual leadership backgrounds, as they share their insights on the place of the supernatural in the church and the world. And now, our hosts, Mark Cowper-Smith and Bob Maddox.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another interview, part of our ongoing podcast that we've had with Les Meredith. These stories have just been amazing to me. And he begins this session in response to a question I had, asking him, is he special, so special that God does these things with him? Or can any Christian basically be used if they're willing to take a risk? So let's go right now to that part of the interview. These are amazing stories, and they're faith-building stories. But I think that some people would think, well, is there something special about Les that you know, are you special? Is it like, or did God pick you out, or what do you think that? Say someone who's maybe not even a similar background as yours, or like you, came from, they're very left brain, or they're very mystical, but they've never had any experiences like this. Can this be a common thing for people if they are hungry for God?
I think absolutely. And I go back to the parable of the sower, that if you're willing to listen and try to reach out and know him, he'll not only reach back, he'll start rubbing off on you. The presence of his spirit around you, you'll become able to detect. And some will be very strong, some will not be as strong. But either way, that's the focus on your relationship and his love and your eternity with him that is the ultimate object of your affection. And so for me, the transition was, God is real. Jesus was the Son of God. The Holy Spirit is with us. I need to know Jesus better. I need to be more like Jesus. And the more I tried to be like Jesus through prayer and worship and reading his word and see how much he loved people, the more I started to love people more. And once I heard stories from other people about having prophecy or healing or seeing angels or things like that, I just believed that why not God not do that for me? If I step out in faith, I'll probably see some of those things. And it's not 100%, but neither was the sowed seed, which was the word of God. You know, 25% of the people were able to retain it and love it and cultivate it and grow 100 times fruit. So I guess I stumbled into being one of the 25% by pursuing Jesus.
I think, Les, we should take a minute and you should tell Bob about you came into the things of the Spirit and you became deeply convicted. I'm putting words in your mouth, but this is a conversation we've had. So correct me if I'm wrong, but you came into the things of the Spirit. You began to experience his power. But as I remember it, you got quite convicted that you weren't a very loving person. You talked about being hard driving, work-centered, task-centered, run the group of people, you know, get the job done, make the quotas, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And then you got really convicted that I'm not loving people like I should. Tell us the story of when your people at work, the question they asked you when they noticed that you'd changed. I just found this hilarious, actually.
Yeah, it's really funny. And my wife would tell you, I got a new husband. And you're like, what? But she would tell you that through that time where I was getting up every morning and I was just saying, Lord, I know I have to love people more to represent you properly. You need to help me with that because I don't know how to do that. You're gonna have to change me from the inside out, and I'm willing. I want to love people more. And it was a softening. And I think it's like, you know, the closer you get to a heater, the warmer you get. But if you don't get close to the heater, even though it's putting off all the warmth, you won't. So I drew close to the heater. And one day, one of my close associates that was one of my employees just finally asked me, she says, what's going on with you? And I said, what do you mean? She says, well, looks like you're nice all of a sudden. She goes, are you dying? No, I'm not dying. So it's not like you've ever been mean or anything, but it's like you notice things now, and you know you're kinder to people, and you know it's good. It's a good thing. I just want to make sure you weren't dying.
Well, maybe the part of you that was needing to die was dying. Yeah. Like Jesus, like Paul said, I die daily. We kind of die to our fleshly nature, which tends to be insensitive to the needs of others.
Yeah.
I want to explore your question a little more, Bob, because you asked the question. People can easily think, well, Les's story is so dramatic. That makes him special, and nothing like that will happen to me. But as you told that story, Les, about getting on that airplane in the presence of your secretary, which means in the presence of great risk, mm-hmm. are you going to step out and function in the supernatural, which can be interpreted as whacked out, spaced out, change your entire relationship with her, with your staff, whatever? But you were faced with the question. Mm-hmm. I've hungered for this. I've asked for this. Now, God, you're giving me an opportunity. In that moment, you have to decide, am I willing to embrace a risk?
Right.
Am I willing to take a risk of my reputation and looking foolish or wrong in order to embrace and move in the things of the Spirit? And you did it. And yeah. I believe that God honors risk. What's your experience been with taking risks with these gifts?
Well, it's as you say, you know, the risk is a faith. Your faith ends where fear begins. Where you believe with fear that God isn't going to work overcomes your faith that he will. And we constantly have to face that, especially when you're dealing with strangers in the prophetic, because none of us are 100% accurate. No one's right. Getting 100% healing. So you're going to fail a couple of times, and it can definitely shake your faith that, well, you know, that person didn't get healed last time. Maybe I'm not anointed anymore. Maybe I prayed it wrong. So there's always a level of uncertainty that you have to cross in order to go forward. I remember one time I had gone to a legal convention and I wanted to get back home. So I left about an hour early and got to the airport, and I saw that it was in Las Vegas, and, you know, there was like 100, you know, boarding areas and Southwest Airlines. And this plane was leaving back to San Diego, and I only had 5 minutes. It was at the 62nd boarding area. Yes. And I was on like 25. So I'm in a hurry. I've just been away from home. I want to get home. But I did. I said, Lord, if there's anyone here that you want to talk to me, and you want me to talk to, I would be happy to do it. And I'm at the 23rd, 24th. And I got to go to 62. And I see this flight attendant. She's probably in her 50s. She's standing by herself. And I thought, well, I'll go over there and I'll ask her if that plane has left. And so I walk over there and she says, yeah, it looks like it's closed the doors. You probably won't be able to get on. And then I heard God say, she needs healing, fibromyalgia. Okay. I'm not going to rush around now and try to get home. So I said, okay, you know, there's nobody around. She was just doing some computer work. And I said, hey, listen, you know, I'm a Christian and I'm trying to learn how to hear the voice of God. And I feel like he just told me to pray for you for fibromyalgia. And she goes, oh my gosh. She says, I just got back to work after being off for 6 weeks. My back hurt, my arms hurt, my shoulder hurt. And they couldn't find anything. And they told me it was fibromyalgia. And I said, well, would you be willing for me to pray right here, you know, that you would be healed? She kind of says, well, okay. And she stayed behind her counter and didn't really advance toward me in any way. And I just prayed for God to heal her from fibromyalgia and to heal her body. And then all of a sudden I got this, just an internal knowing that she had been sad because she wants to connect with a church and she can't find one. And I said, listen, as I was praying for you, I felt like maybe you were reaching out to God and asking him to find a church. Is that right? She goes, how could you know that? I said, sometimes I do hear from the Lord. And I feel like he said you were kind of sad because you don't feel like he's hearing your prayers. And she goes, I really want to go to a church where I can meet some people. She says, I have my kids and that's all I have. And if you'd pray for that, that would be lovely. So I prayed for her. And by that time, some people had gathered behind me three or four people. And I stepped off. I said, I'll talk to you in a minute. And I stepped off to the side and I'm going through this risk reward analysis. I just batted 100%. I could leave right now and I would be completely good. And as I'm staying there, I get the words Jonathan and David. So, no, Lord, I was batting 100%. Who are Jonathan and David? And I got this picture of a young boy who was handicapped. And I said, okay, I'll stay here. And so the people took 10 minutes. I'm standing up against the wall, waiting to find out who Jonathan and David are, thinking I could leave now batting 100%. So they leave and I walk back up and I said, listen, it was really nice meeting you today. But, you know, while those people were standing here, the Lord just put two names into my heart that I feel like are special to you, Jonathan and David. And she started to cry. Jonathan was her son who had just gone through a divorce. He had a handicapped son named David. And she would take David to the park because her son was looking for work and trying to adjust to being divorced. So at that point, she walked from around the counter and hugged me and began to cry and just asked me if I could pray for David to be healed and for Jonathan to find happiness again. And so I sat there and we hugged and I prayed for her with people around. And that was the risk and that was the payoff. And I could have left her a few minutes earlier because I was proud that I batted 100%. But the Lord put that on me and I had to release it. And it was the bigger 100 times payoff for her. It broke down all of her barriers. So that's another example of you had to cross the risk barrier and be willing.
Bob, I think that's the best interview we've had yet. I was deeply, deeply touched by his story of what happened with the flight attendant in the Las Vegas airport. But before we get into that, I think he makes some very, very important points that I think we should highlight. His experience of more of the Holy Spirit accelerated when he realized he wasn't loving people like Jesus loves people. And he began to desire and ask the Lord, help me to love people because I'm not loving them well. And then we see an increase of power in his life. And I think this is really, really important for us to understand that love doesn't follow power. Power follows love. When we eagerly desire, you know, follow the way of love and eagerly desire the spiritual gifts, then what we see is an increase in the spiritual gifts because power serves love. Love doesn't serve power. And I think his story is a perfect illustration of that. And then the other thing that really touches me deeply is this question of risk. That no matter how good you are at this, no matter how great stories you had in the past, the next time God speaks to you about something, you face that same issue of failure. What if it doesn't work? I'm going to look like a fool. Or even deeper, if it doesn't work, maybe the anointing is gone. Maybe I'll never be able to do this again. And so I've had incredibly specific words for people in churches where I'm a stranger to all of them. I don't know anybody. And I'll get a tremendously specific word, but I won't give it. I'll dumb it down. I'll dumb it down to take out the details so that if I'm wrong, I won't look as bad. Now that's a shameful thing to say, but this is human nature. It's what we do. And then they tell me the thing that I just heard. And I think I would have looked like a hero if I just said what I actually got. So it's kind of an ironic, kind of funny situation, but I love the story of the flight attendant, the check-in lady in the Las Vegas airport. And I love the way he introduced his prophetic word to her. If I wrote it down correctly, I'm a Christian learning how to pray for healing and how to hear from God for people. What a humble, simple introduction. I think I might have a word of the Lord for you. I don't know, but something popped into my head. Can I share it with you? Every time I've done that, well, no, there's, I think twice in my life, the person had said no. Most people take it as a compliment that you care enough to ask them. So I found that extremely valuable teaching, teachable moment. And then the risk of, I've batted 100%. I've told her about her fibromyalgia. I've told her about her desire to find a church. Man, I can walk away right now and I'm a hero. And then God gives them Jonathan and David. You think, there's the temptation. If I shut up now and walk away, I did a great job for God. I hit 100 on this one. If I do it and fail, my 100 drops down to 50. And I walk away a failure. Being willing to take that extra step, being willing to risk it all, risk your reputation, risk looking like a fool. Faith and risk are related. We have to embrace that. So the risk of failing to receive more of God, it's always worth the risk of failure to receive more of God. That's what I took from the interview. Absolutely loved it. I can't wait to hear the next one.
Yes, we're so glad that all of you have been listening to this. I was talking to somebody the other day, and they've been watching all of them, and they just love them and how much they enjoy them. And let me just add this little note as we close out here. You were mentioning, Mark, about love and all of that. Faith works by love. And it's amazing. I remember Mario said the same thing. He said that when he looks at people, he feels this amazing compassion. And that's what releases the word of knowledge for him. And so remember that, folks, as you think and as you step out and as you take risks, just let the Holy Spirit fill your heart with love for people. So we're so glad you joined us. And we want to remind you that one of the great things that you can use for learning more about this is our book, Reluctantly Supernatural. Yeah. Age of Reason. It's available at Amazon.com or on our website, ReluctantlySupernatural.com. So we hope you'll come back and join us for more of these, right?
Absolutely. Can't wait. Bob, I've forgotten the rest of Les's interview, and I'm sitting here on pins and needles like, I can't wait to listen to the next portion because it's been so, so good.
So good. Well, God bless you. We hope to see everybody again soon.
Next time.
You've been listening to the Reluctantly Supernatural podcast with your hosts, Mark Cowper-Smith and Bob Maddox. Be sure to check out our website at www.reluctantlysupernatural.com or visit our YouTube channel, Reluctantly Supernatural, for more videos and podcasts. To get a copy of our book, Reluctantly Supernatural in an Age of Reason, you can purchase it at Amazon.com or order it directly from us at our website, www.reluctantlysupernatural.com.